message. From John chapter 12, verse 42 through 43. I'll give you a second to get there. All right. Nevertheless, many even of the authorities believed in him, but for fear of the Pharisees, they did not confess it, so that they would not be put out of the synagogue. For they loved the glory that comes from man more than the glory that comes from God. Now, if you can fast forward your Bible to the book of Galatians, bouncing around a little bit this morning because I'm nailing home the point. Chapter 1, verse 10, and if you can't find it, it's up here on the screen. This is the Apostle Paul, and he says, "For am I now seeking the approval of man or of God? Or am I trying to please man? If I were still trying to please man, I would not be a servant of Christ." Huh. Today, you guys are in for a treat. Really, because the revival might just break out in here because of today's message. I'm serious. Today I want to talk to you guys about the subject, the trap of people pleasing. The trap of people pleasing. Everybody say, "I'm not a people pleaser." That wasn't very convincing. Because the reality is that most of us live our lives attempting to please other people above God. We care more about what other people think of us than we do what God thinks of us. We care more about pleasing others than we do obeying God. Oh, well, what is so-and-so going to think of me if I step out and do this thing that God wants me to do? Or, I don't know, what are they going to say if I do such and such? If I tell them that I'm a Christian, what are they going to, or if I tell them that I, and we're just constantly always thinking about what people are going to say if we do what we know we should do. Or if we do what we want to do. Many of us can't even do the things we want to do or pursue what we want because we are afraid that somebody's not going to like it or they're going to make fun of us if you dress a certain way. Maybe you like a certain way of dressing and you're like, "Man, I really love this style, but I'm concerned because not everybody dresses this way, so-and-so might say something and they might make fun of me." Or maybe you want to live in a certain place or move a certain place and you know your family's going to disapprove of it, so you don't do it. How many of us have not done what we wanted to do because of others and the pressure that others put on us by their opinions and their what they think we should be doing? People pleasing is a trap. It is a trap. Everybody say, "It's a trap." It is a trap, and we all know that, but somehow we keep going into the trap and falling into it time and time again. And today, I'm here to enlighten you with the revelation of God's word that will help you break free from that trap of people-pleasing and help you enter into your destiny and your calling and start realizing that people's opinions do not matter. I repeat, people's opinions about you don't matter. When's the last time a person has died on a cross for you and rose from the dead so that you can have new life and went into heaven and is going to bring you there one day? These people, why are we giving their opinions so much worth, weight, and value? Now, people aren't always cruel on purpose or trying to be mean or trying to disapprove. They're being well-meaning. They're well-meaning people. But we must realize that what God says to us at times, at many times, is going to conflict with what other people think you should be doing. When you start walking with God and you commit your ways to the Lord, He will speak and lead you in such a way that what He leads you to do is not going to be what others would suggest for you. Trap of people pleasing. Can you go back to the screen with the verses? So let's take a look now. Let's take a look, and today I'm going to take you through a journey of helping you see many different scenarios in the scriptures where people have either come under the fear of people and they feared people more than they feared God, and what the results of that was when they were trying to live for the approval of others. And also, I'm going to show you some people in the scripture who chose to fear God, and they committed to fear God and to be more concerned about God's approval than people's approval, and what the results of that was. So this is in the book of John. What's going on here is that the authorities were beginning to believe in Jesus. The him is Jesus. Jesus has come onto the scene preaching and teaching a gospel of the kingdom of God, and he was turning the world upside down. Then whose world was he really rattling and shaking? Was the religious leaders, the Pharisees and the Sadducees, and these people who had power, and they had their traditions, and they had stuff going for them, and they didn't like what Jesus had to say, because Jesus was saying everything opposite of what they were saying. Jesus was getting all of a sudden everybody to follow him, and they didn't care about the Pharisees no more and the Sadducees, and they were losing their power. And so they didn't like that Jesus came and disrupted the status quo. Jesus came and disrupted what was going on in Jerusalem at the time, and they had a problem with Jesus. But nevertheless, Jesus continued on his mission, preaching and teaching and healing and doing miracles, because we know that Jesus was more concerned about the Father's work than he was about what other people were saying about him. So he carried on his work, and many were believing in him. Many were saying, whoa, who is this that even the wind and the waves obey him? Who is this? I have to follow him. I don't even want to. It's against my will, basically, but he's so appealing, he's so amazing that I just gotta go and I gotta believe. And some of the even authorities were believing in him. But, everybody say, but. But, lo and behold, the Pharisees, there they are. For fear of the Pharisees, these people did not confess it. They concealed their belief. They kept it to themselves because they were afraid of what the Pharisees were going to say and do. How many of us have, for fear of what someone is going to say or think or do, not spoken up about our faith in Jesus? How many of us have had opportunities where the Lord was prompting you and you knew it, or it wasn't maybe the Lord, you just knew that you had an opportunity and you kept quiet because you had fear of people? You were worried about these people disapproving of you and rejecting you and not liking you. Well, maybe they won't like me if I tell them about Jesus. The reality is that, oh well, they might not like it. They might reject. They might disapprove. But that's okay, because we are called as believers to live for an audience of one. We're not called to live for an audience of many. I don't get up here and preach every day, every Sunday, because I'm looking for your approval. I have been approved, accepted, and chosen by God himself, and therefore my work in the kingdom comes out of my acceptance from God, which means if I'm never accepted by anybody who I ever preach to, who I ever lead, it's okay. Yes, it might seem. It might sting a little. That's a reality and that's a fact. But you take that to the Lord and you say, Lord, they didn't like it. They rejected me. And they said all sorts of things about me. They put me out of the synagogue. The synagogue was the place of the religious elites, where everyone liked it and was saying, oh, look, they're in the synagogue, the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the religious people. And they had status and popularity there in the synagogue. And these people who believed didn't want to be put out of the synagogue. They were more concerned with the glory that comes from man. I love this phrase. I just came across this as I was studying, and literally I got goosebumps. And because I was like, okay, Lord, what passage do I want to use to communicate the theme of the message? Because there's so many passages I could have chosen. And I was going in one direction, and the Lord led me to this one, and I was like, whoo, that's crazy. They were more concerned with the glory that comes from man than they were with the glory that comes from God. And therefore, out of that, basically what it is saying is that they were more concerned with their appearance in the eyes of people than they were in the eyes of God. And that stopped them, that thwarted their ability to do what God wanted them to do. Let me tell you something very clear. You cannot live to please people and serve God wholeheartedly at the same time. It is not possible. You must choose who you will serve. Are you going to live your life serving people, and in the process, you're not going to be able to fulfill the destiny God has on your life, because there will come a point where people will not like what you are doing in the kingdom of God, and they will come against you with all sorts of convincing arguments. Well, that's not the wisest thing to do. Are you sure you should do that? Well, this scripture says this and this, and they're trying to tell you what God is doing in your life and telling you, no, that's not what God. Who are they to tell me what God has told me to do? Why don't they need to worry about themselves and what God is telling them instead of coming to me and telling them? It doesn't make sense. We must choose to be more concerned with the glory that comes from God. But the glory that comes from God sometimes isn't out in the open. The glory that we receive that comes from God is hidden. People don't always see it. It's behind the scenes. Sometimes God is the only one who sees you doing that. I see you, son. I see you opening those doors. I see you serving those people at your store. I see you not cursing like the rest of them. I see you not going out and drinking. I see you withholding from sexual immorality, even though the rest of the people around you are. Even though nobody around you sees it, you're so hungry for someone to see it, to say, somebody see me. I'm doing these good things. Come on. Can't somebody notice me? We just want to be noticed. And all the whole time, God is saying, I see you. You are my son. You are my daughter. I see what you're doing. And nothing that you're doing in the kingdom of God is in vain. No good work is done in vain. God says everything that you do in the kingdom will be rewarded. You will be rewarded. You will be acknowledged before people one day. But if you choose to sit here and be noticed by people and hunger and slave after being a people pleaser, come on, will you just accept me? Will you just notice me? You're going to miss out on your destiny from God. But God promises, if you are willing to go his way and walk on his path and do his will, no matter the consequences, no matter what people think or say, some will approve. Some will accept you. Some will support you. Some, not all. You cannot please everybody. There is an account in the Gospels about Jesus and John the Baptist, and it's also fascinating because it said the Son of Man came, he came in one manner of living. The Son of Man, it said, came eating and drinking, and they called him basically a glutton and a sinner because he's been hanging out with sinners. And John the Baptist came, and he came eating locusts and fasting and not participating in any of those things, and they called him a lunatic and a loony bin and a crazy man. Nothing will play. Well, come on. Nothing will please people. You do, if you live for pleasing people, even what you do to please them will not please them. Nothing is never something. It's never enough. It's never enough for people. People are power hungry. They want to control. And then when you do something that they like, they still don't like it. And then they hurt, let you down more. God will never let you down. God will never let you down. So live for the glory that comes from God. You have to be willing to wait for that, because it says that we will be glorified with him one day. One day when Christ returns and when all the world knows that he is truly Lord of life, Lord of glory, those who are his and who belong to him will be glorified with him. You and I will be glorified, and all of creation will know that we are the sons and daughters of the living God. Romans 8 tells us that the whole creation is waiting with eager anticipation for the revelation of the sons of God. But we must be willing to wait until that day comes to be acknowledged before all creation for who we really are. And we must be content with knowing that God sees and God knows and God accepts and God acknowledges and God loves and God supports. That he is pleased by you. And therefore you don't have to worry about pleasing other people. falling into the snare and trap. Now, I just had so much fun as I was studying for this message and as I was practicing it a couple days ago. I like to go on walks and go outside when I practice my sermons because I can be loud and I just am walking and I start practicing to the air. You know, it's okay. If you guys won't listen to me, the air and the birds and the bees might listen to me, amen. But I really had fun doing it because as soon as I felt like the Lord was leading me to preach this message, all these different accounts in the scripture started coming to me of people who are living for the praise of people instead of the praise of God. And it was just like, wow, this is all over. So let's just go through some to give you some examples and to give you some examples of what happened when they did that. And then I'll give you some examples of the good side of those who said, you know what, I don't care what people think. I'm going to just do what God told me to do. And let's see what happens as a result of that. So way back at the beginning of time, we can look back at the very beginning and we find that there was a certain individual who maybe, and now it's my speculation, it doesn't say in the Bible that Adam truly was more worried about what his wife was afraid of, what Eve was going to do or say. He didn't want to ruffle her feathers, and he was more concerned about pleasing her than pleasing God, and therefore he didn't tell her to stop what she was going to eat. But it can be implied. If you look at that story, many scholars have talked about Adam was there when Eve ate the fruit. He knew, he watched her eat the fruit that God told them not to eat. Adam did. Why would he stand back and be passive? Well, if you look at many marriages today, many husbands, you find there is a plague of passivity where the men do not step up, encourage, and lead and say sometimes, no, we're not doing that. That is not what God wants us to do. Or we need to go in this direction, because they have a fear, more of a fear for their wives or for these people than they do for God. They're afraid of telling their wife, that's not what God wants us to do, so don't do it. And so they sit back in passivity and they just watch them do something that is contrary to what God wants. That's what Adam did. He was passive because he esteemed his wife higher than he esteemed the Lord. And I'm sorry, no matter how great marriage is, and it is amazing, we are not to esteem our spouses above higher than we esteem the Lord. And as soon as you do that, it is a snare, it is a trap, and it will work against you. And look what happened as a result of Adam's fearing man more than fearing God. All creation, everyone ever since then, felt the sting of sin and the consequences of that decision. And Adam was the one that God said was responsible. It wasn't Eve. Even though Eve was the one who ate, Adam was the one called by God to lead and to protect, and he did not. And so in his passivity, in his indecision, he made a decision. And she made a decision and decided to eat because she was deceived. He was one didn't live in that moment with fear of God trumping the fear of people. He let his fear of his wife, he let his thought, oh, what is my wife's going to get mad at me if I tell her no. My wife's going to get mad at me if I tell her she shouldn't do this. She might. The reality is that she might. There's no promise that she's going to say, okay, honey. Especially once she's got her eyes locked on that and she's like, oh, this is good. It's going to make me wise. Oh, honey, we need to. She was convinced that it was good. So, of course, I would have assumed that if he said no, she would have been, why? Well, who are you? You trying to control me. You did it. She wouldn't be very happy and pleased with him. But if he was looking to heaven and had his eyes set on God and said, God, you know what? I know you're telling me to tell her not to eat this. I know that this is not your will. And I know she might not like it. But because I love her, and because I love you, I'm going to do it, even if I'm not popular in my family for the next couple of days. Even if I get the silent treatment, even if she give me an attitude, it's okay, Lord, because it's for her best. And if we really love our wives, our spouses, or even if you're not married, in a situation like this where God, you know what God wants you to do, but someone else might want to do something else, your friend, whoever, a classmate, step up. Step up to the plate and don't allow them to damage or hurt themselves because you weren't willing and courageous enough to say, God, I don't care what they, if they don't like this, but this is what's right, and so I'm going to tell them. Stand up for what is right. Have courage. Be strong and courageous. Do not fear. Do not fear. So that's Adam. Then I'm going to fast forward and look at, it's great, I'm sorry. It's really fun, these accounts. Abraham, he was another one. This great man of faith, Abraham. We all know Abraham. He was a man of faith. He's the forefather of our faith. And this man did some amazing things. He left everything behind when God called him. And he left the land of Ur of the Chaldeans. And he went off to a land that he didn't know where he was going. And he, by that act, he was justified. And he became the father of all the, those who had faith like him. But on his journey, into the promised land, a famine came. And there was no provision. It was like, Lord, you called me out here, but where's the provision? Like, I ain't got nothing. No water, no food, no nothing. So what did he do? He skirted down into Egypt, where there was a lot of provision. But in Egypt was Pharaoh and his people and these powerful leaders, and they were not godly. And they wanted Abraham's wife. And Abraham, out of fear of people, out of worrying about, well, what are they going to do to me? What are they going to think about me? And so he actually let it. He said to his wife, okay, let's just pretend you're my sister instead of telling them you're my wife, in order to protect himself so that they wouldn't do whatever. In other words, Abraham in this situation acted out of fear of people. He feared what Pharaoh or what the people of Egypt were going to do, and so he became a coward. He cowered. When you fear people, you become a great coward. I hope none of us have on the top of our list that we desire to be great cowards in our lives. But if you live for the approval of people and the praise of people, that's what will result from that. That's what will result. King Saul, great king of the Old Testament. He was supposed to be a great king. He was the first king God chose for his people. Man of great stature, influential, handsome man, handsome looking. And he lost his kingdom. He lost the promise of God for his life because he feared what the people would say if he made a decision that was in alignment with obedience to God. He decided to disobey God and not to do what God told him to do because he feared what the people would do. And he actually said, Samuel the prophet came to him and said, because you have done this, your kingdom is stripped from you. And he said, I'm sorry, but I feared what the people were going to say and do, so I didn't obey God. We must not compromise our obedience to God based on what our fear of what other people are going to think, say, and do. You must realize that commitment to the Lord means yes, God, no matter what the cost, no matter what the consequence, no matter who disapproves of me, no matter who excommunicates me from my family, no matter if my mommy, my daddy, my brother, my sister, my own spouse, my own friend, no matter what, I'm going to obey because obedience is what is most valuable in the presence of God. And when you walk in obedience by faith, you will please the Father, because without faith, it is impossible to please God. Are you worried more about pleasing God or pleasing men? Where is your heart lie? Who are you giving authority in your life? Are you giving people more authority than you're giving the voice of God? And you're going around asking people for their, should I do this? Is this what God wants me to do in my life? Should I do that? And now, I'm not saying counsel is a bad thing, but I am saying that many of Christians are replacing counsel with others, and not going to the Lord, and so they're seeking the counsel of others, and they're not even seeking the Lord about it. How do they know if God wants you to do that? Are they telekinesis? Do they have some? Is God going to reveal to them what you should do with your life? Why would he not reveal it to you? The priority and the order, you go to God first. That shows a lack of faith in our ability to hear from God. That shows that we really don't believe God will speak to us or that God leads us. Because we're going to other people because there we can see them, we can feel them, we can hear them. And so instead of saying, God, you know what? I do believe your word clarifies that you speak and we can hear you and you lead and we can know what you're leading us to do. So I'm going to consult you before I consult others. There's many, many, many more accounts in the scripture of people who were afraid of people or who were afraid of being not accepted by people. Many, and I encourage you to find them. Type in Google the fear of man in the Bible. What does the Bible have to say about the fear of man? I'm serious. You'll find, whoa, a lot of people missed out on their promise. A lot of people disobeyed God solely because they were worried and concerned about what people thought. Now, I want to go to the second verse right here, verse 10 of Galatians chapter 1, and this is where we're going to end today's message, because this is a really powerful account. And in this account of Galatians chapter 1 and 2, the Apostle Paul is speaking and writing, and there are two scenarios in that account in the first two chapters, clear cases of someone who clearly was intimidated by people and didn't want people to reject him, and then somebody decided they didn't care about what people thought. But Paul says in verse 10, "For am I now seeking the approval of man or of God? Or am I trying to please man? If I were still trying to please man, I would not be a servant of Christ." That is a fact. You cannot do both, like I said earlier. Paul is declaring that. If I'm seeking to please man, I won't be able to please him, serve God. Now, the context of this story and this situation goes like this. So the gospel now is going out into the world. Jesus had resurrected from the dead. He ascended to heaven. He appeared to his people. He went back to heaven. And then he called his apostles, Peter and some of the others, to preach the gospel to the Jewish people. But then he called, we know, the Apostle Paul. And Apostle Paul was called to take the gospel to the Gentiles. This gospel message, this newfound freedom in Jesus Christ, that Christ alone is enough for salvation, that you don't need anything else to go with your faith to find salvation. Salvation is found in Jesus Christ alone. And that message was hugely troublesome for the Jewish people, because the Jewish people had thought that there were certain law regulations that they could keep in order to be saved, that in order to be saved, they needed to be circumcised. That was one of the main things. And in the first two chapters of Galatians, the Apostle Paul is recounting what took place and how what happened over time as the gospel was going out. And Paul was preaching the gospel to the Gentiles and saying, free of charge for everybody, salvation for the whole world. Just believe, repent and believe the gospel. There's nothing else, there's no other barriers, no other hoops you have to jump through. Just repent and believe. What started happening is that noise started getting into the ears of some of the Jewish Christians. They were Christians, but they were Jewish. And so they kept some of their Jewish traditions, such as circumcision. And they placed a high value on circumcision, believing that circumcision needed to be done in order to be considered a true believer in the faith, which was not true. God had made that clear. And the same goes with all the other laws and all the other the dietary restrictions and things like that. So then they called them the circumcision party. This circumcision party, these religious people, these Jewish Christians, they found out that this message, that this was happening, and they didn't like it. And so they scheduled a meeting, an appointment with Paul and some of the other apostles in Jerusalem, and they came up, and there in Jerusalem, Peter and Paul, some of the apostles, were hanging out with some Gentiles, and they were, you know, relaxing and hanging and eating together, Jewish Christians and Gentile Christians eating together, because there's no more barrier, there's no more Jew and Gentile in Christ, we're all one in Christ. So they're experiencing their freedom in Jesus, and in comes these religious prigs, or I don't know what you call them, but these guys, staunch guys, that they didn't like what was going on. And as soon as they walked in, Peter, he got afraid of me. Disassociated with the Gentile Christians immediately. Stop eating with them, and he's like, oh, I don't have nothing to do with it. Why was he doing that? Well, it says in Galatians, it says why. And I'm going to go there because I want you guys to hear this. This is awesome. It's in chapter 2. When Peter came to Antioch, this is Paul, verse 11, if you want to be there. When Peter came to Antioch, I opposed him to his face because he was clearly in the wrong. Before certain men came from James, he used to eat with the Gentiles. But when they arrived, that's the circumcision party, the people who were not approving of this new way of Christianity, we don't like it, and we're going to come and let you know, because we just really want control and power. And he began to draw back and separate himself from the Gentiles because he was afraid of those who belonged to the circumcision group. The other Jews joined him in his hypocrisy. Peter was being a hypocrite because why he was fine and dandy to hang out with them and eat with them as long as these others, but as soon as these other Jewish Christians came, he got afraid and he was all concerned about them not liking him or saying, "Hey, Peter, why are you with them?" "Oh, sorry, guys, you're right. I shouldn't eat with them because they don't do the circumcision thing." Peter got afraid. He was more concerned about pleasing these Jewish Christians than he was about walking in the newfound freedom of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And he lost his testimony in that moment because he was afraid, but because he worried and cared so much about what the people thought. And Paul came to Peter to oppose him and say, "What's up with that? What should you quit being a scaredy cat?" Basically, he's saying, how many of us, when we are like Peter sometimes, when certain people come around, we get all, and we don't do any longer some things that we feel free to do in the Lord, or we don't do any longer what the Lord has been asking us to do? Is the Lord our Lord, or are people our Lord? We are called to be bold. That means we stand firm and we don't budge when it comes to the convictions and the commands that God has given us. I don't care what some intimidating person. He is a man. Jesus says in the Gospel of Luke and some of the other Gospels, do not fear what man can do to you, him who can only harm the body, but fear him who has the ability and power to destroy everyone and everything. That is, God has the ability. He creates and he destroys. He is God Almighty. We should fear him instead of fearing people, because people can only harm the outer. People cannot harm your eternal life. People cannot do anything when it comes to your eternal condition and your relationship with the Lord. They can accuse you. They cannot understand you. They can make fun of you. They can laugh at you. They can mock at you. They can tell others and start gossip about you. But you know what? Who knows what is the truth? You know the truth, and God knows the truth, and it don't matter what they have to say. You stand firm in that, and you stand firm. Peter didn't do that. But Paul, and here's where we're going to end. The Apostle Paul, I like him. He reminded me of myself a little bit. You know, he didn't really care that much about what people had to say. First of all, the Apostle Paul received his revelation, the gospel. He received his calling not from man. God made it clear to make sure that Paul got his calling from God himself. He didn't go to men. He said, I didn't go to other people looking for approval and saying, is this what God is calling me to do? He knew and he was confident. God spoke, and therefore I am going to do it. And that means even if people say, hey, you didn't come to the seminary of such and such. You didn't come through our program to certify you and ordain you as a... He's like, I am ordained, and I did go through seminary. I'm ordained by the Lord himself. When the Lord approves of you and puts a stamp of approval on what you're calling is and what you're doing in the kingdom, then it doesn't matter who doesn't put their stamp of approval on it. So, about Paul, he talks about this. Now I have to find it. In chapter 2 of Galatians, I'm not going to read everything because I just want to read the important part to help us see what Paul thought. I can't find it, but that's okay. Here's the situation, is that Paul, he had an opportunity to shrink back as well. He actually was before influential people of his day, very influential people. And he said this, basically he said that they were influential, that they had some kind of status was nothing to me. That means absolutely nothing to me because I'm going to preach the gospel. Doesn't matter if you're the president of the United States or it doesn't matter if you're somebody that no name. I'm going to be the same Paul and I'm going to preach the same message and you can not like it and disapprove me, but I am going to stand firm on the gospel message, the pure message of the gospel, that Jesus Christ is the way and that it is by faith alone in Jesus Christ. And Jewish Christians, I'm sorry to tell you, but I'm not going to come and do what you're doing just because I want to be accepted into your group. How many of us are willing to do things just to be accepted into somebody's clique? Well, I hope we realize that the most important clique is that of God. God's clique, his family, his tribe. So, with that, I want to come to a close. But I want to leave you guys with a charge and with an encouragement, but more of an encouragement, an exhortation, a challenge. Joshua said towards the end of his stint, Joshua, the Joshua who led the people into the land and got them so many victories, he said, choose this day whom you will serve. And then he said, as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. And so my challenge to you today is to choose this day whom you will serve. In the context of what we're talking about, you must choose, are you going to wholeheartedly commit your life to the Lord and say, Lord, I will follow you no matter what, and I commit myself to you. Even if I am rejected, misunderstood, accused, persecuted, hated, cast out, thrown under the bus, it does not matter. I will choose you. Or are you going to choose to relive the rest of your life chasing after the fleeting approval of people and in the process miss out on your promise and your destiny? Mark my words. When God calls you to something and you take his offer on it, you will come into situations where you will have to let people down and you will not be able to please them because you have decided, I'm going to obey God. I'm sorry that you're upset or you're hurt by my decision, but this is what I'm doing. Because I've decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. It doesn't matter. Now, let me leave you with this. Myself and my family we're not just charging you with this challenge. We are right there in the boat with you. And we are saying, coming from experience, we have decided to follow the Lord's call on our life. And we have already come up against many of people who have disapproved of what we're doing, who have accused us of many of things, who have told us this and told us that and try to convince us of this and say, well, you sure you have to do it this way? You sure there's not another way to do it? And we buy it just simply by committing to what the Lord has called us to. We have made people upset with us and they don't like what we're doing. But you know what? We've said, Lord, we live for an audience of one. You're our only audience, and your approval, your praise, your acceptance is all that matters to me. It's all that matters to me. The book of Proverbs says, the fear of man lays a trap. Fearing man produces a trap. It sets a trap because it will never be enough. We need to be free, set free from caring about what others think. And many of us will say, oh, I don't care what people think about me. Right. Sing your heart out in worship to them when we worship at the end. Raise your hand and go, oh no, because people might think I'm not that good of a singer. What are they going to think if I raise my hand? What are they going to think if I go on my knees? What are they going to think if I shout out? We all wrestle with it in all areas of our lives. If you really didn't care about what people thought, why would you get up in the morning, take a shower, do your hair, put your makeup on, do this, brush your teeth, put cologne on? Because we do. And let me tell you this, that it is okay in the sense God has created us all with a desire to be accepted and to be agreed with and for people to. But he created us first and foremost with the desire is to be accepted by him and to be approved by him.
to please him. But sin, the fallen nature, distorts it and then twists it, and now our focus is on pleasing others instead of pleasing God. So don't think that, oh, well, I just shouldn't care at all about what anybody thinks. No, you should. That is a good thing. But your primary priority is to care what God thinks. And in that process, others will actually see and respect some.